You love your mom, but do you like your mom?
Ooh. Yeah.
Do you really? Hi, welcome back to our channel.
I'm Susie.
And I'm Ness. And this is
Mom and Daughter Talk,
where we hope to inspire, encourage, and uplift your mother-daughter relationships. So in this webisode, we are talking about living under one roof together with your mother,
with your daughter.
Yeah. Whatever circumstance it is under, this is going to be a good one. I feel like there are definitely people who are not having fun, you know? Mm. It's not fun for everybody. It can be a pain in the buttocks. But we are hopefully going to relieve some of the stress.
Just some tools to help navigate. We didn't expect to be living together as adults, but in some ways you almost have to look at it like for adult children, like your roommates as well. And know that I can't hover over her. I mean, she is a young woman. So let's say, for example, she's going to a friend's house. I can't be going, so when you coming home? When you coming home? Mm-hmm. It's midnight. Where are you? None of that. She has her own car, own license, all that.
I mean, some daughters like that. Mm. But I don't know. You might want to ask your daughter and see if she prefers that. Mm. Because we actually didn't have that conversation. Mm-hmm. But I preferred if you didn't. Mm-hmm. And you didn't hit me up all the time. But yeah. It's not like we had a sit-down conversation.
And really, I mean, there were times that I would text her if it was getting late, just to make sure she was okay. But not as like, not a thing of trying to spy. Where are you? And
yeah.
Yeah, it's a total different dynamic.
So we'll give you a couple practical tips. Tip number one. Be sure to give space. Mm-hmm. The other person needs space away from you. I know that's hard to hear. But we are two separate peoples living two separate lives. Right. And sometimes you just need to close the door. You need to woo-saw and be on your own.
Yes. Praise God for doors. Because it gives you a separation, right? And really, and it's not a thing where it's indicative of a bad relationship. You don't want to be around each other for a long time.
Yeah, no.
This is really about human relationships in a way. We're talking in particular about mother and daughter, but think about it, in a husband and wife situation, significant others. Like, I think it's healthy to have separate lives and separate interests and then come back together and, you know, be able to talk about it, share things. I can't share anything with you if you've been with me all day because you were there. Nothing to catch up on because you are right there connected to the hip. And so I think that's really important to respect, like you said, one another's time, each other's space, and just knowing that we live autonomous lives, fulfilling lives, but then it's a blessing and we look forward to coming together and catching up.
Yeah. Tip number
two,
don't be easily offended. Mm-hmm. It is so easy, especially when we are all under lockdown. You can't go nowhere as of now. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you feel like I'm stuck in the house, I'm suffocated. And then to add on top of that, you know, you have your mom or your daughter, but in this case, I'm gonna say my mom. In this case, you have your mom just getting on your nerves. Every single thing she does, you don't know why you're upset. You don't know why this bugs you. It didn't bug you the other day, but today for some reason, it just bugs the crap out of you. Mm. Now, you have to look inward on that tip. Because if you're going around being easily offended by what others say, you're going to continue to be upset no matter who you're around.
And also, too, you want to remember that there's a scripture that says that familiarity breeds contempt, right? So sometimes when you're so familiar with each other, it's like a mother and daughter, then it really takes work to kind of not take each other for granted, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it really, think about it like if you had a guest over and if you were getting something to eat, wouldn't you ask them, hey, would you like something to eat? Just little courteous things like that help to deposit into the relationship, deposit positive things so that you can draw from it and know that, oh, wow, this person really cares about me.
And being selfless is key as well. And that actually leads us into our third point, which is be generous to each other. Mm, so yes. As you were saying, when you're being generous to somebody, anybody in life, really, when you're being generous to somebody, that softens their heart. So the soil of their heart becomes soft. Mm-hmm. And so they're a lot more receptive to wanting to even give back to you.
Because just with any relationship, there's going to be some conflicts, right? So when there are those conflicts, if you know that the basis is that you know this person cares about you, loves you, not just because of the relational part of it, but really, I always say, not only do I love my daughters, but I like them. You know what I mean? And that's the difference, right? So I think, again, if you deposit into that realm, when those challenges come up, when those courageous conversations come up, it makes it easier because we know that the foundation is, no matter what, I love you. And there's nothing you can do about it. I love you. Absolutely. Yeah.
And that's the same for a daughter, too. Mm-hmm. You love your mom, but do you like your mom?
Oof. Yeah. That's
do you really? I mean, I don't know. Not going to lie, it took time for us to build this relationship that we have now. And mm-hmm. I feel like it's only going to get better. Absolutely. But there was a time, I mean, of course, when you're a kid, mm-hmm. you don't like your parents all the time. But when you become an adult, you start seeing things through a different lens, it seems like. Mm-hmm. I really feel like God just reveals things to us about our parents. And, you know, that also, you could take that as learning really about yourself, because there are a lot of things that flow mm-hmm. through the bloodline. Absolutely. Okay, from generation to generation. There could be things in there that you had no idea about. So really even be attentive to your parents and seeing, you know, okay, I'm seeing my dad doesn't like to be vulnerable. I don't like to be vulnerable. Ooh, my mom, she's trying to guilt trip me right now. I felt that before. I've done that before. So you kind of pay attention to those little keys as well.
Yeah. And when it comes to family lines, that really is, you know, things that are bad that are passed down, but there's also blessings that are passed down. Mm-hmm. Like, oh my gosh, even in talent, I think about the Winans. You know who the Winans are? There's like 10 of them and they all sing. Oh. Like, every single one of them.
Like the DeBarges.
I guess. But it's like, can you imagine if, and thank God he did that, because can you imagine being the one child that doesn't sing? But their Christmases and Thanksgiving must be fabulous. But yeah, so that's a blessing that's passed down. So, but I like what you said as far as just being watchful and learning a lot, not only from parents watching children, but from children watching parents. I think about like people doing even DNA tests and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. The main reason actually the 23andMe started, I saw this documentary, was because she wanted to find out medically. She's a scientist and wanted to find out medically what were some dispositions that were in her family line. So not just medically, but also, like she said, personality traits, different things that, part of the DNA that gets passed down. If it's great ones, hold on to it, embrace it, help someone else with it. But if it's not so good, then be cognizant of those things as well. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's actually a twofold, because there's the natural things and there's the spiritual things.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Ooh, ooh. Tip number 4 is don't be controlling. Mm-hmm. I know it is hard. Mothers, I guess you could speak to that, but I know it is hard, mothers, to try mm-hmm. not to control your child once they're home in mm-hmm. their 20s and their 30s and their 40s. At some point, you got to let it go. You got to let it go. Mm-hmm. Can't try to control everything that we try to do. We're our own person.
Right. And I think that starts even when they're younger, meaning I always saw myself as a manager of them and not an owner. Right. Mm-hmm. So God used me. Good point. To bring forth life for my daughters, you know, because God has a plan for them. I was just the vessel, but I'm a manager, which means I have an owner or supervisor that I need to answer to. So one day I'm going to stand before the Lord and answer to what kind of parent I was to you, mm-hmm. right? So it really is about knowing that you love them dearly, but you don't own anybody, yeah. even your kids. You may think you do because you feel like, well, I brought you into this world. I can take you out. Yeah, but you got to, again, answer to the boss on that one. If you kill your child, you got to answer to your boss.
Yeah. See, that's that famous saying. And that's the thing, too, especially in Black culture. You got them saying, like, I spent the Black off of you. I brought you in this world. I take you out. I saw you next week. Like, all these sayings where they're funny. But if you say that to your kid all the time, I mean, mm-hmm. that's going to seep down into them in some way. And it's like, you know, you do kind of feel like you own them.
Yeah. And so when she was saying about adult children coming home, but really, I believe it starts when they're young to have that mindset of that you're a manager and not an owner. So when you have that mindset, then when they come back as an adult, you really know, again, I'm a manager. And at that point, really, at a certain point, you don't even manage them. It's like that position, that perspective has changed.
And I do believe it's never too late mm-hmm. as a mother. If you feel like you've been parenting out of ownership, it's never too late. You Absolutely. Can now become the manager and just know that you're not parenting on your own. God's got you. He knew you and your child before you were even formed in your womb.
Absolutely.
And there's something special about the relationship between you two that he wants to come forth, and he wants that to give life as well.
Yeah. Interestingly enough, I was just reading the book of Jeremiah, and in Jeremiah 1, it talks about how God is talking straight to Jeremiah saying, hey, I've known you before you were in your mother's womb, right? And I've called you before you came onto this earth. So think about before they even came onto this planet, God is the author of them, right? So yeah, we just gotta love them dearly, but hold on lightly. Yeah, absolutely.
Love them dearly, but hold on lightly. I like
that. Absolutely.
All right, our final tip number 5, create a new start. Mm-hmm. Like we were saying, it's never too late to rekindle the relationship and build a relationship with your daughter or your mother that you feel like you never got a chance to have for whatever circumstance or whatever situation. Mm-hmm. It's never too late. And you know, God isn't a God of second chance. He's a God of multiple chances.
Absolutely.
And so we have to be nice to ourselves, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. God forbid, but if I had a terrible relationship with you, each and every day I wake up, I have an opportunity to make amends with you.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And we also wanted to hit on this point. If you are coming back to live home with your mom for whatever reason, situation, circumstance, come into it with this mindset that it's only temporary. Be sure to have a grateful attitude. Continue to work on you each and every day. Even though you live with your mom, treat it like a roomie situation if you're an adult. Treat it like a roommate situation. Sometimes you're with your roommate. Sometimes you guys are talking day and night, kikiing and giggling. But then other times you're by yourself. You're working on you. You're praying. You're doing your hobbies. You're working out. You're doing whatever. And daughters, we have to keep in mind that your mom might be going through something that she's most likely not telling you about. Mm-hmm. And she most likely won't be telling you about it anytime soon. Because there are struggles that I don't know about because I'm not a mom yet, but I know there's struggles as a mom that they go through. And, you know, especially if you're a single mom with not just one child, but multiple children who you have to now be the provider over and to make sure you're providing not just resources wise, money, monetary, but you got to provide a roof over their head. You got to provide the food every day. Like, that's a lot of weight to carry. And I think as daughters, we have to reset our mindset and make sure we know that they're human just as well. Mm-hmm. Like when we go through things and we just feel so overwhelmed, we call in our girlfriends, we're like, hey, I need help. Well, who do they call on? You know, I mean, I'm sure they have friends, but it's also, you got to keep in mind, like, it's just so much more weight that they have to carry. So many more mouths they have to feed.
You know, just for a child to understand that and appreciate that means so much to a mom. It really does. Because at the end of the day, we know that that's our role. Any healthy parent knows that that's our role to provide, right? But just for a child to take the time and say those things like, mom, I really appreciate what you do, and just make them feel that way means the world. Yeah, it means the world.
Yeah. And her love language is
words of affirmation.
Yes. So if you don't know your mom's love language, I need you to pause this video. I need you to go find your mother and you need to ask her, mom, do you know your love language? And let's say she doesn't know her love language. You know what y'all can do? What if you don't know your love language? Y'all can get on the phone right now, take the free quiz, okay? Google love language quiz, and it's a free quiz that you can take, and you both can learn what your love language is on the spot. And that will really help with her feeling loved and appreciated.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I think that not just starting as an adult, although you can if you haven't done it to this point, but I just remember when she was about 8 years old, it was her birthday, and I took her to the mall. And we just spent the whole day together, went to the movies, had lunch, and then we were holding hands and walking down. I don't even know if you remember drinking Jamba Juice. And we sat down to drink that Jamba Juice, and you looked at me and said, mom, this is the best birthday ever. And I remember thinking, her love language is quality time. It's quality time. Yeah, absolutely.
That's a good one. I do not remember that. Yeah, I do. Okay, well, we hope you enjoyed and you got some practical tips that you could really use in your mother-daughter relationships right now. So thank you for joining. We are praying for y'all. And if you have any suggestions on more content or things that we can touch on for mothers and daughters, let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to like, don't forget to subscribe, and to share to your friends, mother or daughter.
Absolutely. And you have an amazing, wonderful day.